Well, welcome to the online version of ME3501L. This demonstration is going to be for the glass fracture lab. And so what we're going to do in this lab is we're going to take specimens of glass rod. This is the as received condition of the glass rod. And if you look very carefully at the as received condition, maybe I'll bring this up and I don't know if this shows up on the camera or not. But there are very, very fine scratches on the surface. And those appear as a result of the normal manufacturing and shipping process. There's tiny little surface defects. And if you remember from our 3150 class, the fracture of brittle materials is governed by the defects that they have. And so in this case, since this rod is going to be in three-point bending, which we're going to do on this apparatus over here, there's two supports over here which are 5 inches apart, and then there's a central loading point that's going to be coming down on it. When we do three-point bending, the principal stresses in the rod are going to be axial normal stresses. As I bend this, there's going to be stresses in this direction, and they're normal stresses. And so on the top, where the rod is getting bent in this direction, the top is going to be in compression, the bottom is going to be in tension. And so if I have a scratch perpendicular to the axis of the rod, that's going to influence the load at which the rod breaks. And because this rod has no ductility at all, those scratches can make a really big difference in terms of the fracture strength of the rod. So what we're going to be doing in this lab is we're going to be manufacturing specimens. I'm going to be taking this large rod and chopping it up into specimens which are just slightly bigger than 5 inches. It doesn't matter if you have a little overhang or a lot, as long as your specimen edges are past the two pin supports, you're good. So I'm going to cut this into a specimen of about maybe 6 inches, so I have a half inch of overhang on each side. And then we're going to do a number of experiments, some of them in the as received condition, some of them in an abraded condition. And in order to abrade the specimens, what we're going to do is we're going to take a piece of 240 grit sandpaper. So you can, if you look this up on the internet, you can find out what the grit size on 240 grit sandpaper is, so you know the depth of the abrasions that we're putting on there. And we're going to, once we've chopped the specimen up, we're going to take the sandpaper and we're going to wrap it around the specimen and then go back and forth in a circumferential direction so that we introduce notches or scratches on the surface that are perpendicular to the main tensile stress. And so then we're going to test some of those specimens and we're going to test some glass specimens with no scratches introduced artificially in the as received condition, and then compare the strength of those specimens. And by using the three-point bend calculation and also using K1 is equal to K1C from the strength of the specimen and knowing the geometry of the specimen and the three-point bend apparatus, you can calculate the size of the initial crack in the as received and in the abraded specimens. So that's going to be our objective today. The way that I'm going to cut my specimens is, and by the way, when you do this experiment, it's important not to touch the center of your specimen with your fingers, because the oil from your skin actually can modify the fracture toughness of the glass. If you remember, the fracture toughness is a function of the trade-off between the surface energy that you create when you create new cracks versus the amount of elastic energy that is released. So fracture occurs when the amount of elastic energy that you release as the crack propagates just barely pays for the extra surface energy that you're introducing. And when you put oil from your fingers on there, that coats the surface. And if that goes into the little scratch, then the surface energy of the glass oil interface is slightly different than the surface energy of the glass air interface. So we're going to hold these glass rods by the edges. When I have to handle the middle of the specimen, I'm going to use a paper towel to do that. And it's also important when you're holding onto the glass to be careful not to cut your hand. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the glass rod I'm going to put the glass rod on the surface of the table, and then I'm going to use a triangular diamond file, and it's coated with diamond dust to permit us to abrade the glass. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put some notches on this specimen, and it doesn't have to be very deep, because just introduction of a little notch in the specimen will make it break easily. So I'm going to take some notches. I'm going to go just back and forth on the surface of the specimen, then rotate it about 120 degrees, another notch, and then rotate it another 120 degrees, another notch. Okay, so that's enough, and then I'm going to put my file away here. So, okay, now that we have put our circumferential notches into the specimen, what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the end of the specimen with paper and put the area that I'm trying to fracture on the edge of the table, and then just give it a sharp rap downwards. I'm just going to go, and now what we have is a fractured end on the specimen. The specimen should be about 6 inches long or so. And then I'm going to clean up those shards of glass in just a few moments after we've run our experiment. So here's my as-received glass specimen. It's got irregular ends, but as long as that overhangs the support, that doesn't matter. So I'm going to bring my glass specimen and place it on the three-point bend apparatus over here, touching it only by the ends. And I'm going to ensure that my glass rod is aligned in the sense that it can't be sideways, otherwise your calculations are wrong. So I'm going to make sure the glass rod is centered on the supports and running perpendicular to the supports. And then I'm going to jog the load point down until it's almost in touch with the glass rod, but not quite. Okay, it doesn't have to be that close. The farther apart the point is from the glass rod, the more of a lag you'll have in your displacement before you start seeing any load at all. But that doesn't really matter, because all we care about in this case is the maximum load that we're going to measure. So I'm going to go over to the instron over here. The instron has been set up for the three-point bend. First thing I'm going to do is, with no load on it and with these fixtures, I'm going to calibrate the load cell. So I'm going to push on the load cell button, push calibrate, and ask it to electronically calibrate it. So that'll take us a few seconds, and then the load should show up as zero. Okay, so the load is showing minus 0.1 pounds, which is good enough for a 10,000 pound load cell, so that's done. And I'm going to zero the extension so that for my next specimen, I can just push return and it'll go back to here. And now we're ready to run our specimen. I put down the specimen name here. I'm going to push next, and we're ready to test. And at this point, I'm going to lower the shield, and I'm going to push run on the machine. And what you'll see is, because this is just a brittle material, it has no plasticity associated with it, there's just going to be a linear ramp up, and then there's going to be a fracture. Now, the surface of our fixtures over here is rough. So when you first start loading it, it's going to go up to maybe 2 pounds or so, and then it's going to flatten out, and then it'll start loading up again. So that little table that you see is an artifact of stick slip of the glass. When I first load it up, it's going to be stuck, and then as you increase the load, the glass finally starts to slip on the rough metal surface, and then beyond that point is regular three-point loading. But that doesn't really matter for our experiment that you have that little wiggle in the beginning of the experiment, because really all we're looking for is the maximum load at the point of fracture. And by the time you get to the point of fracture, that little artifact is long gone. So I'm going to plot the load displacement graph. Let's run the experiment. We're seeing jagged lines over here at first because we're not actually in contact with the specimen. And then the load will go up. So it went up to about couple of pounds now. You have 6 lit, now it's going up sharply and it's refracting. Okay. And so I'm gonna push stop. And the maximum load there was about 35 pounds or so. And as you saw, the glass fractured pretty wildly, which is one of the reasons why we want to have our safety glasses on in this case. So I'm going to lift this wheel and use the brush and dustpan to clean up the glass. And then I'll show you the fractured surface on the glass specimen if it's visible. Okay. And I'm not sure what you can see on this video, but there's some really cool surface features on the glass. If you were here and you could see it up close, you'd see these almost conchoidal fracture lines following the surface of the crack. Those are called Wallner lines. If you're interested in why those are generated, you can look that up, W-A-L-N-E-R lines. And it has to do actually with the dynamic propagation of the crack. As the crack is propagating, stress waves are bouncing between the edge of the specimen and the crack surface. And the crack moves pretty close to the speed of sound in the specimen, and so you get these weird undulations of the crack surface. Really cool. Totally irrelevant to this lab, but really cool. Okay, so I'm gonna dump the glass specimens out into our sharps container here. And then we're ready for our next experiment. Okay, so the last specimen that we tested in front of you was the as-received specimen. Here's a sample of an abraded specimen where you can see the circumferential scratch marks due to the abrasion with the 240 grit sandpaper. This one's actually been abraded by somebody a little bit too much. Really, you should only have to do one or two circular motions with the sandpaper and that's enough. Because even the slightest scratch on the surface modifies the behavior of the material tremendously. But in any event, what we're going to do is we're going to put this specimen into the three-point bend fixture and test it. And you might want to think about what you expect in terms of the distribution of the data for the random surface scratches that you get as a result of manufacturing versus the uniform surface scratches that you get as a result of abrasion with the 240 grit sandpaper. I'm gonna put this on the three-point bend fixture and we're going to break this one as well. Okay, and we're about to run this, the experiment. Again, I have load plotted over here versus displacement. And as you remember, what we're going to see is we're gonna get some wild wiggles at the beginning, because the contact point hasn't made contact with the glass yet. So, and then after that, it'll make contact and the load will go up a little bit and then you'll see a small plateau at about 2 pounds, that being stick slip while the specimen is moving over the rough surfaces. And then the load will go up linearly until the fracture of the specimen. So this is the wiggles because we really don't have any significant load. This is just electronic noise. Okay, so now we went up to about 2 pounds and now we're going up linearly until the fracture load. And this one fractured at about 29 pounds or so. I'm gonna stop the experiment, remove the specimens and clean it up for you. And so we're going to provide you with data from a number of as-received specimens and a number of specimens abraded with 240 grit sandpaper. And then you can follow the analysis guidelines in your lab write-up.